How are we doing this morning? Good? It's so good to be gathered together to worship Christ. If you'll stand, this first song that we're going to sing is based on biblical truth that we find in 1 Kings chapter 18. And in this passage, the Lord displays his power as Elijah goes against a large group of false prophets that worship the god Baal. And it says this: "The fire of the Lord fell and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, and the soil, and also licked up the water in the trench. When all the people saw this, they fell prostrate and cried, 'The Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God.'" Amen. And so our God is a God of miracles and power, and today we worship with confidence that he is the Lord, our God.
Yes, our testimony is the living proof. And if you doubt the evidence that he is able, open your eyes, people, get ready. Just build an altar, drench it in water.
Build an altar, drench it in water, stand back and wonder.
church. You know, this morning we wanted to pause for a moment. We wanted to pause and be reminded of what Christ has done for us. And one of the ways that we do that as a church regularly is by taking communion. And so in a few minutes, we're going to take communion together. And if you don't know what communion is, it's a family meal for those that have put their faith and their trust in Jesus Christ and who call him Lord. And so if you haven't done that, if you haven't trusted in the name of Jesus, we want to ask it during this time that you would consider what it would mean to trust Christ. Consider what it would mean to turn away from your sins and put your faith in Jesus. And so we'll take this meal together as a body of Christ. And if you haven't accepted Christ, we want to ask that you would refrain in this moment from taking it with us. During this time, we are reminded of the Lord's goodness and we reflect on his mercy that he displayed for us on the cross. And as we prepare our hearts for communion, I want us to read Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5, and it'll be on the screen. And it says this: once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. You used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live this way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. And by our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, just like everyone else. But God, being so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. And it's only by God's grace that you have been saved. What a beautiful reminder, church, of how we were, those of us in Christ were once dead, and now we have been brought to life. And so as the elements are passed around in this room, we're gonna sing a song over you. And I just wanna encourage you to reflect, repent if you need to, and at some point during this song, you can take the elements on your own.
Your mercy, I'm saving. to repentance. Your loving kindness leads me to
are righteous, you are sovereign, you are worthy of all of our praise. We thank you, Lord, that we can come into your presence today, that a holy God gave us access to him. What a joy to know you, Lord. What a joy to be together in the house of the Lord. We thank you, God. You are worthy. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You can have a seat. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord together today? Woo! Praise God. Welcome to Harvest. My name's Stephanie. I'm the Central Women's Director, and I'm so glad you decided to join us this morning. This is your first time. Special welcome to you. So glad you decided to check out Harvest this morning. We'd love to answer any questions and help you get connected. I'll be out in the lobby after the service. I would love to get to know you and help you feel plugged in here at Harvest. For everyone here, we want to make sure you're plugged into the life of the church. It's easy to come in and sit in a seat but not feel really known. And so that's one of our prayers, is that you feel known when you come in here. And one of the ways we do that is through the Connect card on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. So pull out your phones right now and click the Harvest Bible Chapel app on Church Center and let us know that you are here, let us know your prayer request, and also be able to see what groups we have coming up, what classes we have, and also be able to look at sermon notes and the growth guide. There's a lots of ways to get plugged in here at Harvest, so we want to make sure you know all of those resources. So take time to click the Connect card on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. Next Friday, we have our Women on Mission Prayer and Worship Night. I'm so excited. This is out of an overflow of what happened at the women's conference. We said, there's more we need to do. God's not finished yet. And so we're really excited to get to worship and pray together and be able to dive into teaching and be able to talk about what God has done in our lives this past year. So we'll be here at the Meadows campus on Friday, May 3rd from 7 to 9 p.m. It will have English and Spanish. So if you're Spanish speaking, we will have special songs and we'll have the lyrics up in Spanish. So we want to make sure that everyone is able to come and enjoy this service together. So you can sign up at harvestbible.org. It's totally free, so just come. It's going to be awesome. For our men, we have our Forged Men Retreat June 7th and 9th at Camp Harvest. It's going to be awesome. If you've been to Camp Harvest, you know it's a good time. So it's going to be so great to dive into God's Word, worship together, and be with men from different churches. So it's going to be an awesome event. You can sign up at harvestbible.org. Men, hope you guys make it out there. We're going to be praying today for Chicago West Bible Church in Chicago and Pastor John Kelly. He's been doing incredible ministry out there, and we want to be praying for like-minded, gospel-believing churches. And so excited to pray for them and their services today. Before we do that, we're going to pray for our continued worship through giving. Matthew 6:21 says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." And one of the key ways to know where our heart is to see where our time goes and where our money goes, right? And so as we go into this time of giving, we want to think through, how can I be able to give to the Lord who's been generous to me? How can I give in light of how God has granted me grace and provided for me in all these areas of my life? So as we give today, it's not just a checklist item. We want this to be an act of worship. Whether you give today or throughout the week, and there's several ways listed to give on the screen, we want to be able to pray, because this isn't about just the money we give, it's about our hearts toward the Lord. We want to surrender our hearts to the Lord and trust him with the fruit of our giving. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for who you are. Lord, we thank you for what you're already doing in our services today. God, we thank you that we get to come together and worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, I pray that as we give today and as we give throughout the week, that, Lord, you would help us to give from a cheerful heart. That, Lord, you'd show us the areas of our life where maybe we aren't surrendered to you, or the areas where we don't trust you to provide. Lord, we want to give fully and freely to you because you've given fully and freely to us. Lord, I pray that whatever we give, Lord, that you would use it for your glory, that you'd use it to build up your church, that you'd use it to bless families in need, you'd use it to bless ministries going on in our church and outside these walls. Lord, we ask that your will be done and your kingdom come as we give today. Lord, I pray for Pastor John Kelly and his services. Lord, be with their church, be with their staff. Lord, fill them afresh with your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray that you encourage them in this season as they are having new people come in and they are having their services. Lord, bless them and keep them. Lord, I thank you for Pastor Jeff, and Lord, I pray as he preaches today that, Lord, you would fill him afresh, that, Lord, you would give us ears to hear, that, Lord, we are not hearers of the word only, but, Lord, may we be doers as we leave the message today, that, Lord, we want to honor you in everything we say and do. So, Lord, we ask that you humble us today, that you prepare our hearts for what you have for us. So, Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for who you are. You are so good, so holy. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. But before we open up to 1 Peter chapter 2, stand up and say hi to someone you don't know.
For those of you who don't know, first of all, my name is Jeff. I get the honor of teaching the Bible here, and so we're going to do that in the next few minutes. You have a Bible, I want to invite you to open it to 1 Peter chapter 2, 1 Peter chapter 2. While you're turning there, just quick update. I've been gone the last 2 weeks because, I nearly died, but here I am. I had a 99% blockage, one of my arteries that I knew nothing about. I didn't know anything about it. I just felt a little bit weird, went to the hospital because my doctor said go to the hospital. I was like, what? Didn't I need to go to the hospital? Showed up there, and they were like, yeah, we got a problem. Went through all the tests. They did an angiogram the next day and put in a stent in my heart, which, so I didn't feel bad when I went in. I didn't feel bad when I came out. I felt the same the whole time. I actually think it was all a hoax. It was just a way for them to make money. Or the videos they showed me are real, and I narrowly escaped death, which must mean God wants me to be here for a little while longer. Which, apparently, I only had a little bit of oxygen going to my brain because it was blocked. So if you thought the sermons were good before, right? Or it could go the other way. Do you know what I mean? Like, the drunk sermons were amazing, and these ones make way too much sense now. So, I'm honestly thrilled to be back with you. I'm excited, actually, to be able to talk about the Bible with you for the next few minutes. 1 Peter chapter 2, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. I actually want to show you some weird pictures here as we get going. You've followed the news, I'm sure, and recently there's been a big uproar on college campuses all across the United States, a lot of anti-Semitism and people arguing one point or another regarding what they think should happen in the Middle East, which is not a new debate, and certainly the Jewish people this is not new for them to be kind of in the firing line. It's happened throughout the ages. It happened prior to the Holocaust. It's happened since the Holocaust. It seems like it's a repeated thing. One of the interesting things when I was in college that I got to study was World War II propaganda. And it really influenced me a great deal, mostly because the question that most of us have is how could an entire group of people, the German people, buy into the idea that these Jewish people were to be killed so easily, and to turn a blind eye to the fact that there were these death camps just in their backyard? There's lots and lots of people who tried to answer that over the years, but one of the reasons that happened was because the Nazis were really good at dehumanizing the Jews. And this is the kind of thing that still happens these days, but I wanted to show you some of the pictures that the Nazis used to use. Like, they would put these big posters up in the middle of the cities and show, in order to, you know, show what Jewish people were like. Here was one of them. This is a really common one. You can see that they've got money here. Most of the Jewish people in those particular days had found work in money lending. It was the only work, honestly, oftentimes they could do. And so nobody really loves their bank, right? Nobody here is like, yay, my bank's amazing when they charge the interest. And so a lot of the Jewish people were in the position where they were actually charging interest on some of the people. And when things got bad, people, of course, didn't like them. But the way that they made them look was like the really bad guy, the miserly old horrible guy, Ebenezer Scrooge-ish, right? This here shows that they are actually communists, supposedly. You can see that there's a whip down here because that's essentially what they were trying to do, supposedly, was whip you into submission while getting your money, and their main goal was communism. None of that's true, but that's the way that they were depicted. They went from being depicted, though, as people, at least in that first one, they were depicted as people, to being depicted as things that were not people. If you had mushrooms in your backyard, what did you do with the mushrooms in the backyard? Well, you cut them down. They're a weed that needs to be eliminated. Well, here's a Jewish weed with all of the Jewish weed friends. And you can see the Star of David there in the middle. And they need to be locked down. That's actually pretty mild for what came a little later. Here's one that is of the Jewish people as some sort of parasite. This is Europe, right? This is a map of Europe. They are a parasite over Europe that's trying to suck the blood and life out of the people of Europe. So if you see them as people, okay, you won't treat them the way you ought to treat them because they're actually not fully human. The worst one I've ever seen is this one. They are animals. This looks like the, you know, Starship Troopers or some like big bug that's come from outer space that we're all trying to kill. But you can see the exaggeration of their faces, and they look like these are all their legs all the way down here. And this is a castle out in the distance. This is what they're doing to the European world. It's a wasteland because the Jews have come and they have destroyed the whole thing. I don't want to leave that up there. It's pretty disgusting. This is the way that you can justify in your minds the destruction of people, is that you talk about them in such a way that they're less than human. It's no mistake that in our society today, if you ever get into the abortion debate, that the discussion is not about babies so much as a fetus. It's a gathering of cells in the body. The moment we start calling it a baby, that conjures up ideas of humanness. We murder people. But if it's not a person, it's not murder, right? So you got to be careful with the words when it comes to propaganda. You want people to think certain things about the other side, that they're wicked and horrible and less than human, so you can do to them what you want. Our language and images you use to describe people really, really affect the way we act. Now, I would say the same thing for you personally and me personally. The way you think about yourself, the images that are conjured up in your minds regarding yourself, your God, your world, the people who are in your church together with you, all of those images drive you toward a kind of acting toward them. It's amazing how powerful imagery is in forming the way that we act toward one another. And the biblical writers know this, that images drive things. And so what you'll find when you read through most of the New Testament, Old Testament, what you'll find is imagery being used for Christian people. How should you think about yourself? Well, you should think about yourself as family. You should think about yourself as the body of Christ. You should think about yourself as the temple of God. You should think about yourself as adopted sons and daughters. Do you see the imagery? And all of those phrases, all of those images are supposed to convey something to you regarding who you really are. Peter, in 1 Peter, is filled with them. You ever sit down with 1 Peter and just write down all the images? It's actually kind of fun. What does Peter say about us in terms of imagery? What does he use to describe the church? Well, I'm going to focus on three. There's a whole bunch in this passage that we're going to look at, but I want to focus in on three of them. Here they are. Number one, we are newborn infants. We are living stones, and we are royal priests. Newborn infants, living stones, royal priests. So let's take each one in turn. Newborn infants. Look at verses 1 to 3 in 1 Peter chapter 2 with me. So, building off of chapter 1, right? So, put away all malice, all deceit, and hypocrisy, and envy, and all slander. What do these have in common? Deceit, hypocrisy, envy, slander. A lot of them have to do with the sins of the tongue, yeah? Certainly they have the sin of an attitude toward other people, but that attitude is played out in the way we talk, right? We slander them, right? We lie to them. Now, this is really interesting to me before you get in too far to this, because if you go to 1 Peter 1:22, which is just the previous chapter, here's what it says: having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love. God has saved you and he's purified your soul as a Christian for obedience to the truth of the gospel, for, there's a purpose in it, sincere brotherly love. The outcome of your Christianity is supposed to be sincere brotherly love. We're supposed to love one another earnestly from a pure heart. Do you know what it looks like when you don't love one another with a pure heart? Malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, slander. Before we get into the newborn infant thing, isn't it crazy the way Christians talk about each other? I mean, it's amazing how terrible we are in the way that we talk about one another. I want you to picture in your mind a Christian person who has really wronged you, who you don't like them. And I'm pretty sure that the reason that you don't like them is because they committed one of these against you. If you want brotherly love to flourish, watch the sins of the tongue. If you want it, or if you want it to die, avoid them. Put them away. We've been saved for brotherly love, for a family affection with one another, and the chief mark of our family affection for one another is going to be the way we talk to and about each other. So how do you talk about your Christian friends? Dude, I got to tell you, man, as a pastor, I have read things about me that I don't recognize. I don't recognize them, but I would also say I've said things about Christian brothers and sisters that are deeply unkind and uncharitable, and it's the thing that kills it. But here's the image, right? Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk. You see the image, right? Is it your little baby longing for the milk of its mother? My son, when I first, the first child we had a real hard time getting him to sleep. I've shared that with lots of people before. Usually if a young couple comes in and wants to talk to me about something, sometimes it's about my kid is not obeying the rules of the book that they gave us. And I'm always like, yeah, they don't read. So they usually don't obey the stuff that they're told to at that age. And at any age. But no one ever told me the hardest part about having a little baby is going to have getting them to sleep. But that was the hardest part at the very, very beginning. And so we read the book and we decided, okay, what we're going to do is going to let them cry it out. And that didn't work. My wife and I would yell at each other. And I, of course, being the guy, I was like, let him cry. And she's like, I can't. You know, he's an hour into it. I don't care. So finally, she got to the point where every time that she would lay down with him, and he would nurse, he'd fall asleep every time. If you've been around a baby who won't be settled by anything but their mother's milk, this is the image that Peter's playing with here. That we, as Christians, are newborn infants who are longing, or ought to long, for the spiritual milk. The question in your mind here should be, okay, if we're supposed to have a longing that makes us cry out loud and insist on only having that thing, what is it? What is the pure spiritual milk? What are we specifically supposed to long for? Right, okay, so in order to answer that question, here's what I want to do. I want to go back to 1 Peter chapter 1 toward the end of it. 1 Peter chapter 1, 20. You can answer every question like this with the context, okay? Every question. So if you ever sit in a Bible study and someone says, what do you think this word means? The first thing you're thinking is, let's read the context. And believe it or not, just like in every letter you've ever written in your entire life, the words are defined by the things that they refer to in their context. Yes? So here's a good example. Peter says, you've been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, right? Do you see the imagery? Through the living and abiding word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of the grass. The grass withers, the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And this word of the Lord, is the good news that was preached to you. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the message about his salvation and the commandments that he gives to those who are his own. So, chapter 2, put away all malice and deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander, like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk. So what's the pure spiritual milk? It's the word, right? I mean, if you were sitting down and reading the thing just in one sitting, you'd be like, oh, wait a minute, the thing we're supposed to be longing for is the word? The gospel message and the commandments that Jesus has and tied to everything about him? It's through this word that we, it says, by it you may grow up into salvation. If indeed you've tasted that the Lord is good. So in other words, if you want to be a healthy, growing Christian, you have to connect yourself to the tool God is using to grow you, which is the pure spiritual milk of the Word of God. Just like a baby can only grow with the milk that is provided for it by a mother, so the only way you're going to grow is by connectedness, a yearning, and a satisfaction that comes from that connectedness to the word of Jesus. This is all over the place in the New Testament. I got to tell you, it's actually quite shocking how many different places this comes up, okay? The Great Commission, at the end of Matthew, Jesus is going to, He's going to ascend back up into heaven, but he says, he said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And the job of a pastor then, and any missionary anywhere, including you, is not just the baptizing, getting them into the kingdom, but teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. Where does it describe what Jesus has commanded us? In his holy word. In fact, the way that Jesus chose to do this is that he gave his word, his commandments, to the apostles, who then taught it in letters, and we have those letters in a book. Isn't that cool? The early church didn't have it in a book. We do. Acts 2:42, when the church gets together, here's the thing they focus on. They devoted themselves to what? To the apostles' teaching. Jesus commissions them, right, to teach them to obey all that I commanded you. And they do, and the church gathers around. And when they gather together in a corporate group like this, what do they focus on? The apostles' teaching. Fellowship, breaking of the bread, and the prayers. In other words, every church worth its salt will connect you to the apostles' teaching, which is the very word of God. 2 Timothy 3, but as for you, Timothy, writes Paul, continue in what you've learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you've been acquainted with the sacred writings, and those sacred writings are able to make you wise for salvation. Through faith in Christ Jesus, all scripture is breathed out by God. It's his very words, and it is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, training in righteousness, that the man or woman of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. It's really explicit. How you grow, according to the New Testament, is that God has given his teaching, the pure spiritual milk, into the hands of these apostles. We have it in a book, and when you gather around in a church, the pastor is supposed to open the book. Listen very closely to me. You are not obliged to go to a church where they do not open the book. You don't have to stay there. If I stop opening the book, if I stop drawing my dumb board back here, so that you understand what the words mean in their context, if I stop doing that, you leave. Because the only way you're really going to grow in Christ is by being connected to the pure spiritual milk. It's the only way. It's the only way it's going to happen. Unfortunately, because so few churches and so few pastors actually believe, so few Christians know this, we don't eat pure spiritual milk. We don't eat healthy. We eat like trash. We eat like I did when I was in college. When I was in college, do you know what I'll tell you my diet. Okay, you'll wonder, why does he have heart disease? Here you go. When I was in college, in the morning, I would wake up and I would eat a Hostess pie. Do you know the Hostess pie? They are God's gift to us. They are wonderful, absolutely wonderful. Don't read the back of them. They're made out of petroleum, but they taste so, so good. So I ate an apple pie every morning for breakfast. And if I didn't have that, I would often get a donut instead. For lunch, I ate Stag chili. Stag is a brand, and I loved it. If you talk to my wife, who was then my girlfriend, I remember talking, waxing eloquent about how much I love Stag chili, and I used to tell her, I'm going to eat this every day, right? It's got to be good for you. It's not. But I ate Stag chili, and then for dinner, I always ate Top Ramen, and that was my diet. Hostess pies, Stag chili, and Top Ramen. I remember one day laying in my bed saying, I just don't feel very good to my girlfriend. And she said, have you thought for a minute about how you eat? And I'm like, what's the problem? Well, you're gonna have a heart attack someday. Yeah. It's the first time she's been right in years. Okay, but I gotta tell you, We laugh at that. We think, oh, that's so ridiculous. Of course, you should eat healthy and stuff. Okay, Christian. If you are going to be a spiritually healthy individual, if you're going to be somebody who's actually growing in all the ways you ought to be growing, you have to connect yourself to the pure spiritual milk, which is the Word of God. You have to. And if you don't choose to connect yourself to a church that preaches it, to a small group that talks about it, to a daily time where you can sit down and consider it, if you don't connect yourself to it, you are just going to be laying on your bed one day and being, I just feel so spiritually sick. Yes, of course you do. Stop eating the pies. I've worked with care pastors for years. One of the beauties of being in a larger church is that you can get specialists, people who are really, really good at caring for people and doing pastoral care among them. They go to hospitals and things, and they do a lot of counseling. And one of the things I've learned from a lot of the care pastors I've worked with in my life is that is that most of the people that they deal with and the challenges that they're having are there because they have somehow ignored the word of God. Whether it's just through, I don't have time, or I don't make it to church very much, or whatever, they don't sit underneath an explanation and discussion of the word of God. And now their life is sick. Yeah. Yeah. So we're newborn infants. We're also living stones. Look at verse 4. 1 Peter. As you come to him, a living stone, rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood. There's an image here that's not hard for us to understand. Jesus is called the living stone, rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious, and you yourselves are living stone. This is a building, and you're being built up as a spiritual house. So Peter said, all right, let's go to the lot where the construction crew is ready to build the house. Now look, in those days, the way you would start by building a wall or a house or anything like that is you had to choose an appropriate, what they call cornerstone. And it was the shape and the strength of the cornerstone, right? It was the stone that sat at the very corner, bottom corners of wall. It's the stone that sits down here. And all the other stones in the entire wall are built in line with the cornerstone. So it's really important, my builder friends, which cornerstone we choose. Because as the cornerstone goes, so goes the direction of the house, right? If you get a weak and horrible one, the house is going to fall down. If you get one that's too big or too awkward looking, the house is going to have some weird wall going into it. But if you get the right cornerstone, the house is actually going to be in really, really good shape. So, Jesus is a living stone. In a minute, you'll see that he's called the cornerstone. But he's rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious. So, so God is on the work site, and there's a bunch of others there who are on the work site. In this case, Peter's referring to the Jewish people, the Jewish nation and leaders. And he's saying that what happened in history is that, okay, so they're going to get to the work site, and we're going to build up the people of God. This is a building for the people of God. And we get to the work site, and God is over in the corner. He's got this wonky looking stone. And all the others come up and go, that is a wonky looking stone. When we were coming here earlier, we all said together, whatever we do, let's not get a stone that looks exactly like the stone you've got in your hands. We do not want that stone. It doesn't fit our expectations. Get rid of it. We reject it. It's worthless. This is the way that God, or Peter's describing the way that people of Israel responded to Jesus. You're not the right Messiah. You don't fit the qualifications. You don't do it the right way. We expect it to be different. We reject you, but God is like, no, this is the one I've chosen. This one right here. And it's going to be the cornerstone. This is going to be, it's precious to me. It's beautiful to me. So that idea, just in your mind, rejected by men, but chosen and precious in the sight of God, is not just what Jesus is. We too are like living stones, just like he was the living stone. And we're being built up in line with Jesus, and the rest of those builders are still looking at it and going, that house is gross and a mess. It has nothing, it's not what we want. And yet for God, it's exactly what he wants. It's exactly what he wants, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Now, he's going to go into detail here with a bunch of passages from the Old Testament to say it's always been this way. This was God's plan all along. It stands in Scripture. Behold, I'm laying in Zion a stone in Zion, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and it's a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. You can hear the offense. Ooh, it's offensive, that stone you've chosen. It's nothing what we want. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. And so Jesus is the stone that the builders reject, but God is holding them precious. We, too, then, like living stones, experience exactly what Jesus the living stone did. You follow that? So what did Jesus the living stone experience? Well, there's bad news and good news. First, the bad news. I'm always a guy who wants, I want the bad news first. If we're stones like him, and he was rejected by men, will be rejected by men. I find myself here at Harvest repeating this idea over and over again. It seems like the Lord takes us through passages of Scripture repeatedly that have as part of them this emphasis, that the society around us is not going to cheer because of us. That the society around us, in fact, will likely reject us the way that the society of Jesus' day rejected him. I'm pretty convinced that God wants you to hear that and me to hear that, because we're in a moment. Like, we're in a moment where a lot of us grew up thinking, oh, it'll never be like that. And we're a little bit surprised because it's become like that. But, you know, let's not be too surprised, because the Bible has said this repeatedly. It's just that we lived in a society, in a culture that didn't really persecute as much as they are now. So you have passages that Jesus himself said in John 15, if the world hates you, know it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you. By the way, you want to know how you know you're of the world? Well, the world loves you as its own. But because you're not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they'll also persecute you. In 1992, I applied to be the resident advisor of a dormitory at Western Washington University in Washington State College, so like Northern Illinois, a state university, 1992. I made it all the way through all of the interviews, right? I mean, I had a good background. I'm relatively trustworthy. I'm caring for people. I get to the final interview, and it's in front of the resident advisor, a couple of other resident advisors, the resident director, and like one, a representative from the university president's office. And they're sitting in this room together, and they interview me, and everything's going really great until they get to this question. What are your views regarding homosexual acts? They even asked it that way. What are your views regarding homosexual acts? Do you believe as a Christian that they are sinful? 1992. I said, there's a lot of things that are sinful. So yes, I do think that, but I also think that sexual sin is a common thing for most people these days, and my job is actually to love people who are in sexual sin and to call them out of it, because I think it's ultimately good for them. But I would not separate out somebody who's involved in that kind of sexual sin as opposed to somebody who's sleeping with their boyfriend or girlfriend all the time. I don't. No more questions. They closed the meeting. I went out. They said, we'll be in touch with you within the next, day or so. It was like 1 hour, and I received a note. It was for email. I received a note from them saying, thank you for applying. We're going to go in a different direction. And that shocked me in 1992, because I'm like, what in the world is this? I mean, what are you talking about? This is so crazy that this is the case. Okay, fast forward until just a few years ago, living in Canada, our church had a program where we would try to hire summer workers and the government would help pay for it because we were like one of the biggest hirers for summer workers, and it was considered to be kind of an internship sort of thing. For years, everything had gone great. The government thought it was great. But the prime minister of the country decided that if you wanted to have Canada summer workers on this particular summer, you had to sign a document and say that you support the government's position on abortion, which in Canada was anytime for any reason. And so we were like, wait a minute, what? How can that be the reason? This summer workers have nothing to do with this. So we couldn't sign the document. And so thus began the first of many years of the government finding all sorts of reasons why it is that our church could not participate in the programs that they offered for everyone else. And I could tell you story after story after story after story as it's increasingly getting that way. And I don't really know what to say. You know, you know that this is the way it's going. You know this. We all know this. We feel it in our bones. We are rejected by men. The temptation that you and I are going to have is to constantly want to be liked by them. Because I don't want to be disliked. I want to get the RA job. I want to be able to have the summer workers. I want to be able to do all the things and be accepted by the wider society. And you've seen other Christian leaders and friends who have all decided that, yeah, I want to be accepted by the wider society, so I'm going to acquiesce. I'm going to give up this issue so that they will praise me instead of malign me. So we've jumped headlong into supporting that. I don't want to be rejected by men, but listen, the Jesus we follow is rejected by men. But the good news, he was chosen and precious by God. Hebrews chapter 10 has this fascinating little, the people in the book of Hebrews who are being written to are really considering falling away from Jesus. Seriously, they're thinking about, you know, it'd be much easier if I just acted like a Jewish person in this community. I wouldn't face the same kind of criticism as I'm being faced with as a Christian. So what's the price? I'll believe in Jesus, but go back to my Jewish way of life. And the writer's like, no. If you go back, it was all for naught. So here's a part where he tries to encourage them. Recall, he says, Hebrews 10:32. Recall the former days when after you were enlightened, right? Came to faith in Christ, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, and sometimes being partners with those so treated. For you had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property. All of these bad things happened, and you guys were like really cool with it. Why? You knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. Therefore, don't throw away your confidence, which has a great reward, for you have need of endurance so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. The way that you maintain and continue in the midst of any kind of persecution, whether it's like we're going to kill you persecution or I just don't like the way you look persecution. The way you continue is you have a better position than what they're offering you. You won't care about their opinions if you know that you have the opinion of one much greater for you. I started dating my wife when I was in college, girlfriend, right? And it was off the back, about a year off the back of me dating this other girl who broke my heart. I remember sitting across a table when the other girl spoke to me and basically rejected me. I drove down the street and I turned my car off and I wept. in this car. What is going to happen? I went to another college because I wanted to get away from it all. I get to this other college. I meet Jeannie. I meet Jeannie. She's magnificent and wonderful. And after dating her for a while, I get a letter from the old girl. I'm so sorry and everything's sorry. And I'm like, you know, how are you doing? And I've just been thinking about you and blah, 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 blah. Okay? You know what I did with it? I don't care. So what happened? What happened between, I miss you so much, to, I don't care. And the answer, I had a better and lasting possession. Right? But I don't care what you say about me at this point, because I don't care if you rejected me or if you want me or don't want, it doesn't matter to me, because she wants me. If the Lord has chosen you and has pleasure in you, what difference does it make whether or not you're rejected here or not? What difference does it make? Honestly, when you're standing before God, when you're going, as I did in the last few weeks, into the room where they're like, you might not live through this, I'm going to tell you right now, you're not going to be thinking about what they thought. You're going to be thinking about, was I faithful? Was I faithful? You and I have need for endurance. Please hear me. Please hear me. You and I have need for endurance. The days are evil and things are getting very difficult. My fear is we're going to be surprised by being ostracized, and then we're going to want to give up. Do not give up. Do not give up. Those who continue will receive a great reward. You have a better possession. You have a better possession. All right, last one. Royal priests. Here's the end of this passage. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Look at these words. Chosen, royal, holy, a people for his own possession. That you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. See, once you were not a people, now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you've received mercy. Royal priesthood. These words don't hit like they probably should. We just don't have the background that we ought to, or that we shouldn't say we ought to, that they had in that particular day, okay? So the way you get ahead in a democratic society like ours is merit. You're good at a thing. And in the United States, one of the things that we love about our country is it doesn't matter where you come from, it doesn't matter who your mom and dad are, it doesn't, if you're good at a particular thing, selling real estate, throwing a baseball, if you're good at a particular thing, you can rise to the very highest of heights. Pure meritocracy. That's why we tell our kids, you know, you can be anything you want to be. It is such a modern Western mindset. You can be anything you want to be. You would never have said that in the days of monarchies. Because one thing they could not be is royal. You can be anything you want to be. No, you can't. You will be what your dad was before you. You will be what your family is. And wherever they fit on the socioeconomic spectrum, that's where you're going to be. Because that's the way it worked in days gone by. In monarchies, the way you get ahead is through your family name. Privilege comes from pedigree. There are places, by the way, in the northeastern part of the United States where this is still the case. You can get into Harvard because you have a family name of people who gave a lot of money to Harvard. But the further west, quite honestly, you get, the more meritocracy it is. It's a whole history to that. But you need to understand that for the most of the world, they've not operated under democratic societies. What they've operated under is, no, you're tied to whatever your family is, and that's your place. So you're not going to be royal. That's why movies and plays like Cinderella were so intoxicating. Look at this amazing story about this girl who actually ended up becoming a princess. That is nuts. Never happens. Never will happen. It's a fairy tale. And then along comes the Bible. You. Yeah, I know you. You are royal. I'm royal. Yeah, you're a son of the king. It was because of mercy. Listen, it wasn't because, you know, you did something amazing or anything like that. You're a son of the king because he made it so. But the story of rags to riches is actually a pointer in our world to what God has done in Christ for you. I'm actually convinced that all of those great stories only exist in the history of the world so that people like you and me who are Christians can say, you want to know what happened to me? Cinderella. That's what happened to me. I am royal. Priests were chosen. You didn't just get to be a priest because you decided when you graduated from high school, I want to be a priest. You were a priest because you were part of the right family. Both of these, this language is all of these things, to be a chosen, you don't choose your race. You don't, being holy is to be set apart. You are the nation that you're born in. And yet what this all says is no, but what God has done is he's taken you and he's placed you into these things that you have no business being in. Your story is a pauper to prince story. And when that starts to get inside of you, it does something. You know that? You know what it does? It makes you proclaim the excellencies of him who called you. We won a trip to Rarotonga in the Cook Islands once. We lived in New Zealand, went to a travel show, and they had this deal where if you stood in this certain part of the travel show, every like hour were given trips away. It's kind of cool. You had like a 1 in 100 chance depending on where you were standing. And they had hidden some, you know, star on the ground or behind a picture or something, and the person who was standing closest to it got it. My wife was pregnant with our first child. She carried straight out here. So she's wandering around in her 5'4" frame. And this big Samoan man saw her and said, hey, come here. Can you just stand right over there against this wall? She's like, oh, okay. And she stood there. And they did their big, you know, drum roll. And they walked over and they turned over this picture. And Jeannie had been standing right in front of the thing. And all of a sudden I was like, oh, we won. We're going to the Cook Islands, which are magnificent. We had a free trip to the Cook Islands. I don't know how many times I have told that story to people. I had the guy's name for a long time. I've told that story in detail, in little detail. I've told it dozens and dozens of times because that's what happens when somebody grants you such great favor. You talk about the people who grant you great, great favor. But here's the thing. God has granted you a favor that that goes beyond any tropical paradise you could ever imagine. I went from being an object of scorn and wrath, deserving of eternity in hell, to a child of the king who will sit at his table forever and ever and ever. Amen. And that move right there should do something to my mouth. Oh God, thank you. But not just make you, oh, thank you. Doesn't it make you kind of bold? Okay, because the moment you start telling me that I am the son of a king, that changes everything. The whole world can look at me like I'm an idiot, but I'm a child of the king. That's what's true. That's what's real. So I can even stand up in front of 10,000 people who want to spit venom at me. I could be like Polycarp, who was killed in the early centuries for being a Christian and fed to the lions, and I can stand up there and I can say, we'll not give in because I have a Lord who has made me his child and adopted me forever, and he's never done me wrong, and I will never, ever turn away from him. And you can do that with that kind of boldness because you know what's true. Listen very closely to me. I have a homework for you. Are you excited? Here's the homework. This next week, you know what you're going to do? Every morning that you wake up, I don't care if it's while you're laying in your bed, while you're sitting on the side of your bed, you know, because you're old and you got to get things warmed up a little bit before you get going. I don't care if it's in your shower or you turn the radio off in your car or you do what I ride a bike around and you just have silence for a minute. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to play the what is true game. The what is true game is you repeating over and over again in your mind what is true about you as a child of God. Repeatedly, I am a son of the King. I am chosen. I am favored by God. I am loved. I was destined for hell, and I was drawn back to him, and he has lavished on me love and acceptance and peace and ultimate joy and prosperity one day. Even though right now it might be hard, there is a day in the offing where I will stand before him, and every ounce of attention and energy I paid to him will be worth it in that one moment. Oh, God reminds me what I am. You do this. You do this every single day, and you see how much you start talking about him. You see how much you start giving for him. You see what kind of worship it produces in you. I'm going to grade this. Okay, let's pray. Father, I'm thankful for my friends and thankful for your word, and I'm thankful, Lord, for Peter and the beauty of the writing and the details and all this stuff. But God, I pray more than anything these images would fill our minds. They're so instructive for us. Help us, Lord. Help us to know what's true and right, that we might finish the race, Father, and receive the prize that is ours in Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand.
this I'll say before.
Come on, church, you know it's true. Come on, we're singing this.
When he shall come with trumpet sound.
Come on, lift your voice.
A holy nation. We are a chosen people because of Christ. But maybe today you don't have a rags to riches story. Maybe you've never become a part of the family of God, and I'll say today is a good day to make that decision. So if you want to come forward and be able to have someone pray with you and hear what would this look like for me to come to know Christ, we'd love to talk with you. We'll have people up front. Or maybe you are in Christ, but you haven't been believing like you are. You haven't been accepting the truth of how you are loved and accepted, or maybe you're going through a trial. We want to pray with you. That's what we do as church family, is that we are able to bear one another's burdens, and we want to speak truth over you. So come forward. We'd love to pray with you. If you're new, I'll be in the lobby. I'd love to say hi to you, get to know you, help you get connected here at Harvest. But for everyone here, as you go out on mission today, know that you are loved.